Anne Bronte, Agnes Grey, chapters 1 through 5. Anne Bronte's first novel, published in 1847 under the pseudonym Acton Bell, is a short, semi-autobiographical account of a young woman's experience as governess for two wealthy families. English novels featuring governesses had grown increasingly popular in the 19th century. One scholar, Sarah Hughes, calculated that 230 fictional works published between 1749 and 1930 included governess characters, with more than half, 140 such novels, published in the 50-year period between 1814 and 1865. The popularity of the governess novel peaked between the 1840s and 1860s. Among the more well-known titles featuring governesses are Jane Austen's Emma, published in 1815, Charlotte Bronte's Jane Eyre, published in 1847, and William Thackeray's Vanity Fair, serially published in 1847 and 1848. Governess stories, though, remain popular, especially among female readers. A search for governess on Amazon reveals many contemporary romance variations on the governess tale. The Cinderella Governess, A Governess for the Brooding Duke, When a Duke Loves a Governess, Octavius and the Perfect Governess, The Governess and the Sheik, and for the adventurous reader, The Governess's Examination, a Victorian Medical BDSM Tale. Thus, Anne Bronte decided to write about a governess not just because she had worked as one. Likewise, her sister Charlotte's decision was not just because she saw the potential in Anne's book, or because she herself had worked as a governess. Having earlier published a volume of their poetry that sold only two copies, the three Bronte sisters each agreed to write a novel. They are likely, then, to have considered the literary marketplace and to have recognized the popularity of governess novels. This popularity reflected a larger cultural preoccupation with the plight of governesses. The rise of the middle class in early 19th century Britain led to an increased demand for governesses who could teach children, especially daughters, the skills and habits needed to succeed within their social class. These governesses, therefore, needed a genteel background, and thus tended to be either the daughters of middle-class fathers who had lost their fortunes, or, like the Bronte sisters, the daughters of clergymen who, though far from rich, were well-educated. As the middle class increased in the growing capitalist economy of early 19th century England, so too did its inevitable creative destruction, causing fortunes to be lost and daughters to seek employment, a fate blamed not on the economic system, but on the follies of fathers. As the Governess's Benevolent Institution Report of 1847 claimed, the imprudencies, extravagancies, mistakes, or crimes of a certain number of fathers were needed to sow that seed from which we reap the harvest of governesses. What was the plight of these formerly middle-class women? That the supply of eligible governesses greatly exceeded demand. That, although genteel, they were forced to work for wages, and that these wages were notoriously low. As many scholars have noted, this plight became something of a cultural obsession in the 1840s, even though there were far more women working as domestic servants and mill hands, 750,000 versus about 25,000 governesses in 1851, and even though the work conditions and wages of domestics and industrial workers were far worse than what governesses had to endure. This cultural preoccupation with governesses can be explained by their curious class position. Once middle-class women now working for wages and residing in middle and upper-class homes. The preoccupation with governesses was also shaped by their taking over some of the child-rearing roles in a culture that prized motherhood above all. In other words, the governess embodied a threat to the correctness and stability of the class system and to the ideology of womanhood. Of course, a more insightful critique of these matters would center on working-class men and women. The governess figure served to obscure these more destabilizing fears by displacing them onto a far less threatening population. Or as Catherine Hughes, director of creative nonfiction at the University of East Anglia, puts it, rather than ponder the disturbing implications of a hungry and disaffected workforce, Contemporaries prefer to think about the more manageable problem of 25,000 unhappy middle-class women. That's the cultural moment in which Anne Bronte wrote her first novel, Agnes Grey. At the same time, Emily wrote her only novel, Wuthering Heights, and Charlotte wrote a novel, The Professor, which was rejected and wouldn't be published until after her death. Influenced by her sister's Agnes Grey, Charlotte then wrote what has become the most famous governess novel, Jane Eyre. Although written later, this novel was published 2 months before Anne's, which in turn was published as part of a three-volume novel, or a three-decker as it was called then. The first two-thirds consisted of Wuthering Heights, overshadowed by Jane Eyre, and appearing almost as an addendum to Wuthering Heights, Agnes Grey, with its realistic details and average heroine and unsurprising plot, received little attention. And the little notice it did receive was mostly dismissive. As one reviewer put it, the novel left no painful impression on the mind. Some may think it leaves no impression at all. I would argue, though, that it's precisely this lack of imaginative flair, Anne's reliance upon her own experiences with none of her sister's gothic-y apparatus, that makes Agnes Grey worth reading. With no mad women or ghosts haunting her, no love that transcends time, Agnes Grey suffers the fate of many educated women in 19th-century England. She would have been unable to gain a formal education, since women weren't admitted into Oxford and Cambridge until the 1860s. The first women's college in England wasn't founded until 1873, and women couldn't earn degrees from Oxford and Cambridge until 1920 and 1948, respectively. There would, though, soon be another option for women like Agnes. 1 year after the novel's publication, Queen's College London was founded, specifically to train governesses. The women hired as governesses, as I noted, tended to be genteel ladies who were financially strapped. In Victorian England, professions for educated middle-class women were severely limited. The low-paying job of governesses was almost the only job available to them. As M. Jean Peterson, professor emeritus at Indiana University, explains, if a woman of birth and education found herself in financial distress and had no relatives who could support her or give her a home, she was justified in seeking the only employment that would not cause her to lose her status. She could find work as a governess. Women such as Agnes Grey had two options, according to Elizabeth Langland in her biography of Anne Bronte: educate other young women and small children as governess and schoolmistress, or become a writer. Bronte worked as governess for two families. In April 1839, she began her employment with the wealthy Ingham family, but by December she had been dismissed for being unable to control the wild children under her tutelage. In May 1840, she began teaching the children of the even wealthier Edward and Lydia Robinson. In 1842, her brother Branwell joined her to tutor the Robinsons' eldest son. Things would go better here for Anne with older and more well-behaved children to be responsible for, until she resigned after 4 years of service, immediately following her brother's dismissal. He had had an affair with Mrs. Robinson. At home, urged on by Charlotte, Anne began her novel. The sisters wrote their books in close collaboration, explains Bronte biographer Juliet Barker, reading aloud to each other and discussing the handling of their plots and their characters as they walked round and round the dining room table each evening. Anne begins the novel by having Agnes Grey speak directly to the reader, explaining that all true histories contain instruction. She goes on to modestly assert about her narrative, "I sometimes think it might be useful to some and entertaining to others." We learn at the end of the novel that Agnes has compiled the narrative from her diary entries. After explaining her motive for writing this account of her life, Agnes tells us about her family background, some of which resembles Anne's own. We learn that Agnes's father is a clergyman in the north of England, that of six children, only two, Agnes and her sister Mary, survived infancy, that she was educated by her mother and father, that she and her sister had little acquaintance with her less educated neighbors, and that the two sisters enjoyed their childhood sitting at their work by the fire, or wandering on the heath-clad hills, or idling under the weeping birch, talking of future happiness. This Edenic moment is soon lost. Agnes's father, attempting to provide more than a clergyman's income for his family, invests in a trading company. But his ship never comes in. In fact, it sinks. Agnes describes the effects of this loss on her father. The mind preyed upon the body and disordered the system of the nerves, and they in turn increased the troubles of the mind, till by action and reaction his health was seriously impaired. Bronte here explains how loss of financial security can impact one's psychological well-being, which in turn can affect one's physical health, generating a downward spiral of depression and obsession, self-loathing and self-destruction, an inability to escape what Agnes labels her father's morbid imagination. Agnes goes on to explain, in a passage worthy of Dickens, the cascading effects of financial loss upon her family and their heretofore comfortable life. Our clothes were mended, turned, and darned to the utmost verge of decency. Our food, always plain, was now simplified to an unprecedented degree. Our coals and candles were painfully economized, the pair of candles reduced to one, and that most sparingly used, the coals carefully husbanded. We sat with our feet on the fender, scraping the embers together from time to time, and occasionally adding a slight scattering of the dust and fragments of coal, just to keep them alive. As for our carpets, they in time were worn threadbare and patched and darned even to a greater extent than our garments. Out of a desire to help her family in its time of need, 18-year-old Agnes proposes to work as a governess. Her family responds with astonishment at the very notion that someone so young, shy, and unworldly should take on this task. Her sister pointedly asks, "What would you do in a house full of strangers without me or Mama to speak and act for you, with a parcel of children besides yourself to attend to, and no one to look to for advice? You would not even know what clothes to put on." Confident that she will be able to teach young children, and wanting to lessen her family's economic woes, Agnes, like Anne Bronte, eventually convinces her family to allow her to find employment. In a letter to her friend Ellen Nussey, Charlotte describes the resolute Anne's departure. "Poor child, she left us last Monday. No one went with her. It was her own wish that she might be allowed to go alone, as she thought she could manage better and summon more courage if thrown entirely upon her own resources." In her fictionalized version of this departure, Anne has Agnes take one last backward glance at the comforts of home and feel the chill of her uncertain future. "I looked back again. There was the village spire and the old gray parsonage beyond it, basking in a slanting beam of sunshine. I hailed the wandering beam as a propitious omen to my home, and I hastily turned away, for I saw the sunshine was departing, and I carefully avoided another glance, lest I should see it in gloomy shadow like the rest of the landscape." Agnes's gloom is not dispelled by her arrival at the home of the Bloomfield family. The grandeur of the Bloomfield home and its contrast with her family's recent immiseration, rather than helping overcome her anxieties, exacerbate these. "When we entered the carriage road with the green lawn on each side studded with young trees, and approached the new but stately mansion of Wellwood," Agnes explains, "my heart failed me. For the first time in my life, I must stand alone." Juliet Barker, in her biography of the Brontes, describes the home upon which Wellwood is based and where Anne was governess as impressive and intimidating. It was a splendid mansion, far more aristocratic than anything the Brontes had ever had contact with before. Three stories high, it had an imposing 18th century frontage. Once inside the equally imposing Bloomfield manse, Agnes sits down to dinner with her new employer, Mrs. Bloomfield. "My attention," Agnes says, "was almost wholly absorbed in my dinner. From distress at the toughness of the beefsteaks and the numbness of my hands, I would gladly have eaten the potatoes and let the meat alone, but having got a large piece of the latter on my plate, I could not be so impolite as to leave it. So after many awkward and unsuccessful attempts to cut it with a knife, or tear it with the fork, or pull it asunder between them, sensible that the awful lady was a spectator to the whole transaction, I at last desperately grasped the knife and fork in my fists, like a child of 2 years old, and fell to work with all the little strength I possessed. Bronte has built up our expectations for young Agnes's initial encounter with her new rich employers, but then undercuts this drama with this peculiar scene. Why does she spend time on such an unimportant event? Why are we watching Agnes chase meat across her plate instead of getting into the meat of the story? Bronte includes this scene because it reveals not just the class difference that causes Agnes's anxiety or her crushing youth and inexperience, but because it reveals how painfully shy and introverted she is. Agnes is so aware of the impression she is making struggling to cut meat with her cold, numbed fingers that she can barely converse with Mrs. Bloomfield. This scene, with its minute focus on the trivial, is meant to be comic, but it also reveals a key aspect of Agnes's psychology. Aware that a spectator is observing her, in this case her employer, Agnes can barely accomplish the simplest of tasks. And in comparing herself to a 2-year-old, Agnes reveals just how weak and vulnerable she is, how cripplingly infantilized she can become when observed and judged. Bronte here compellingly shows the painful effects of a debilitating self-consciousness and social anxiety. While Anne's awkwardness is the product of a crippling reserve, it's worth pointing out that many young governesses experienced a loss of appetite when eating with the families they worked for. Catherine Hughes notes that one result of the ordeal of dining with employers was that sheer nervousness often made it impossible to do more than pick at food. Eventually, Agnes is introduced to the children she will be in charge of, 7-year-old Master Tom and his 2 younger sisters, Marianne and Fanny. At first, Agnes has a positive impression of her new charges. They seemed bold, lively children, and I hoped I should soon be on friendly terms with them. But these hopes are quickly dashed. Tom, we are told, traps and kills birds, feeding them to the cat, cutting them to pieces, roasting them alive, pulling off their legs and wings and heads. To a contemporary reader, this animal torture suggests an incipient psychopathy. To a 19th century reader, one might assume this torture would be less troubling. However, many Victorians were aware of and opposed to the mistreatment of animals. The Royal Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, the RSPCA, was founded in 1824. Parliament passed the Cruel Treatment of Cattle Act in 1822 and the Cruelty to Animals Act in 1835, the latter outlawing fighting or baiting any bull, bear, badger, dog, cock, or other kind of animal, whether domestic or wild nature. Although it was met with occasional resistance and frequent ridicule, legislation prohibiting the abuse of animals progressed through the 19th century. Even the notion that adolescent abuse of animals might predict adult cruelty was a subject of conversation. As a member of Parliament, William Alexander Mackinnon explained at an RSPCA meeting in 1840, "The boy not awakened to a sense of his wickedness when he is tormenting a poor fly with a pin will grow up a hard-hearted, selfish, and cruel man." For Victorians, this trajectory from an animal-abusing child to a cruel man was not due to brain chemistry or sexual sadism, but to inadequate moral instruction. A lack Agnes seeks to redress when she warns Tom, "You have heard where wicked people go when they die, and if you don't leave off torturing innocent birds, you will have to go there and suffer just what you made them suffer." Most of those in need of this moral instruction, according to the dominant Victorian view, were of the lower classes. They were, after all, the ones who abused farm animals and enjoyed dog fights. According to Oxford historian Brian Harrison, those seeking to deter animal cruelty, such as the RSPCA, believed that the state must curb animal cruelty as part of its general responsibility for promoting the citizens' moral growth. The society in its early years was quite unashamed in focusing primarily on cruelty committed at the lower end of society, quite explicit in its belief that cruelty was more common there than elsewhere. We can see some of this class prejudice in Agnes Grey. Agnes's father is, presumably, a college-educated clergyman, and her mother, a squire's daughter, who relinquished all the luxuries and elegancies of affluence to become a poor parson's wife. The Bloomfields, by contrast, are nouveau riche. Mr. Bloomfield is a retired tradesman who had realized a very comfortable fortune, or as Anne's mother describes the family, purse-proud tradespeople and arrogant upstarts. Because of this background, the Bloomfield children were raised with no appreciation for education. They seem hardly to have been schooled at all. They can barely read, and they rebel against any form of instruction. The difference between the smart, well-behaved Gray children and the insubordinate and ill-educated Bloomfield children may, however, be the result not just of the Gray family's superior cultural habits, but of their superior intelligence. Bronte believed in the pseudoscience of phrenology, in which the shape of a person's skull determined their mental capacity, and phrenology was often used to justify the existing social order. Nonetheless, Bronte has a much more capacious and much less class-restricted view of morality than seems to have been common among the English upper classes. In her second novel, The Tenant of Wildfell Hall, she depicts the cruelty and violence of the upper classes, especially in her portrayal of her protagonist Helen's husband, Arthur Huntington. When not whoring, drinking, or gambling, Arthur spends his time hunting, an aristocratic sport not proscribed by legislation in 19th century England. In fact, fox hunting wasn't outlawed in Britain until 2003. His violence and immorality are apparent in his appearance. Even as he courts Helen, he is all spattered and splashed and stained with the blood of his prey. He even strikes his pet dog. Helen writes, "His favorite cocker, Dash, that had been lying at my feet, took the liberty of jumping upon him and beginning to lick his face. He struck it off with a smart blow, and the poor dog squeaked and ran cowering back to me. When he later calls the dog to him, it clings to Helen, so he becomes enraged, snatches up a heavy book and hurls it at his head. The poor dog set up a piteous outcry and ran to the door." More than a product of class, Bronte sees this violence as particularly male. Men, whether aristocrats or proletarians, seek to express their power and dominance, and often do so violently. Thus, Tom's father doesn't object to his son's mistreatment of animals. Instead, he acknowledges doing exactly the same thing when he was a boy. Tom's uncle laughs at this behavior and declares Tom a fine boy. The most extreme instance of this violence towards animals occurs when Tom finds a nest inhabited by five young birds. Bronte describes his anticipation at torturing these creatures. He was standing over it with his legs wide apart, his hands thrust into his breeches pockets, his body bent forward, and his face twisted into all manner of contortions in the ecstasy of his delight. Whether or not she consciously understands the connection between this violence and the construction of a boy's sexuality, Bronte describes Tom as he is on the verge of torturing animals in a sexually suggestive pose, legs wide apart, hands thrust into breeches, face twisted with ecstasy. Shockingly, to keep Tom from torturing these birds, Agnes, while Tom lists his imminent tortures with fiendish glee, drops a stone upon his intended victims and crushes them flat beneath it. This mercy killing is rebuked by Tom's mother, who objects to her son's distress over having had his lethal amusement interrupted. When Tom tortures animals, and when Arthur Huntington kicks his dog, they are taking out their frustrations on and asserting their superiority to those beneath them. Tom presumably is frustrated by the constraints of childhood, Arthur by his inability to control his wife. Such violence, though, often was not displaced onto animals, but directed against women, We see a hint of this when Tom justifies hitting his sister. He says he's obliged to do it to keep her in order. Even at his young age, Tom knows that as a man he must maintain order, must keep women in their place. This assertion of male dominance can be seen as well when the 7-year-old Tom forces his sister and the 18-year-old Agnes to watch how manfully he used his whips and spurs on his rocking horse. When Agnes tells Tom she hopes he wouldn't use his whip and spurs on a real pony, he replies, "Oh, yes, I will. I'll cut him like smoke." This young boy equates manhood, Bronte suggests, with the use of violence to tame and control. In linking abuse of animals with abuse of women, according to Oxford English professor Sally Shuttleworth, Bronte was following an emerging thematic concern in the Victorian novel, where masculine treatment of animals, and particularly dogs and horses, functions symbolically as a key to the more hidden psychological and possibly physical abuse of women. Tom's whipping his rocking horse is a rehearsal for whipping a live horse and for intimidating and abusing women. For Victorians, there was a fundamental difference between men and women, boys and girls. Males were by their nature more aggressive, and their education should recognize and reflect this difference. This attitude toward the proper education of boys is perhaps most fully expressed by Sarah Stickney Ellis, who in conduct books such as The Wives of England, The Women of England, and The Daughters of England expounded upon women's proper role. In The Mothers of England and Their Influence and Responsibility, Ellis, explaining how mothers should educate their sons, asked, "Why are boys so mischievous, disorderly, and troublesome?" Her answer, "Because they have a superabundance of mental and bodily energy, which must find exercise in one way or another. Without this restless and energetic principle in their nature, where would be the man of enterprise? Where would be the traveler, the engineer, the statesman, or the philosopher? Boys, in other words, are more aggressive by nature, and mothers need to acknowledge this trait because it enables men to fulfill their manly duties, to take risks, face challenges, compete against other men, and succeed in the worlds of trade and science and politics and academics." However, this aggression is potentially dangerous. It must therefore be controlled and channeled through a proper moral education, one that is neither too lax, which allows boys to express their aggression as they desire, or too severe, which will cause boys to express their aggression as rebellion. As Ellis argues, "Unless a boy is to some extent humored or amused and made happy in the parlor with his parents, he will be in danger of seeking the excitement and interest which his natural temperament demands. Perhaps the greatest temptation to which boys are subject is to use their strength in an unfair or ungenerous manner, in short, to use it so as to take advantage of comparative weakness. The conviction that they have power, when accompanied with a sense of mastery, is unspeakably agreeable both to men and boys." Ellis understands that behavior such as Tom's is not an innocent expression of childhood desires, but an initiation into a life of cruelty. "It may seem but a trifle," she explains, "that a boy should abuse the poor ass by the wayside simply because he can and dare do so, that he should tease his own dogs and flog his own pony because he has the power to do so, that he should torment and ill-treat his sisters because they have not the strength to defend themselves. But when we think to what all this may grow, it ought to be regarded as one of the surest symptoms of a mean, ungenerous, and tyrannical disposition which a youth can exhibit." Bronte shows this male impulse to control, this mean and tyrannical disposition, by emphasizing Master Tom's willfulness, his refusal to follow Agnes's commands, his need to assert his own power. "Master Tom," she writes, "not content with refusing to be ruled, must needs set up as ruler, and manifested a determination to keep not only his sisters, but his governess in order." If nature explains Tom's resistance, Nurture explains his two sisters' resistance. They have not been properly, if at all, educated and socialized. Thus they behave with the same willful opposition as their brother. 6-year-old Marianne is obstinate, refuses to complete her lessons, and, Agnes explains, apparently preferred rolling on the floor to any other amusement. Things are no better with the youngest child, Fanny, a mischievous, intractable little creature, given up to falsehood and deception, and alarmingly fond of exercising her two favorite weapons of offense and defense, that of spitting in the faces of those who incurred her displeasure, and bellowing like a bull when her unreasonable desires were not gratified. These wild children raise the vexed question of how children were perceived in 19th century England. I say vexed because over time attitudes toward children changed, and because these attitudes differed based on a child's social class and gender. So it's hard to identify a single prevailing Victorian belief about the nature of children. Rousseau's belief that children were innocents living in a state of nature until corrupted by civilization continued into the 19th century. Thus, Maria Edgeworth in Practical Education speaks of the artless expressions of sympathy and sensibility in children, and the delight adults may receive from children's genuine language of nature. At the same time, a contrary view developed which saw children as needing instruction to overcome their innate corruption. As the evangelical social reformer Hannah Moore put it in her Strictures on the Modern System of Female Education, it is a fundamental error to consider children as innocent beings, rather than as beings who bring into the world a corrupt nature and evil dispositions, which it should be the great end of education to rectify. Oxford professor Sally Shuttleworth suggests, as evidenced by Agnes's repeated comparisons of children to animals, that Bronte's understanding of children might also have been influenced by Robert Chambers' highly popular Vestiges of the Natural History of Creation, published in 1844. According to Chambers, when the human brain is in the state of infancy, we see in it something approaching the character of the brains of the inferior animals. Often the actions of children, especially in their moments of play, and where their selfish feelings are concerned, bear a resemblance to those of certain familiar animals. Agnes seems to hold all of these views. Initially, that is, before she meets the Bloomfield progeny, she has a belief in the goodness of children, that she can make virtue practicable, instruction desirable, and religion lovely and comprehensible. But her experiences with these children quickly erode this perception. In addition to Tom's cruelty, Agnes must confront children who litter the carpet with fragments of toys, sticks, stones, stubble, leaves, and other rubbish, who rifle through and spit into her purse and threaten to burn it, who threaten to throw her desk out the window, and who regularly escape to the out-of-doors to avoid her instruction. Agnes's wished-for solution to the problem of these ungovernable children is corporal punishment. Repeatedly, she wishes the family would allow her to hit her charges, believing, for instance, that in response to Tom's misbehavior, a good birch rod or a few sound boxes in the ear would keep him in line. Absent of this punishment, and with the children unmoved by her anger or approbation, Agnes must get creative, throwing Tom on his back and holding his hands and feet until he calms down, regularly pinning him in a corner, running after her pupils to catch them, to carry or drag them to the table, and often forcibly to hold them there, refusing to speak kindly and ignoring them, withholding food and physically shaking them. But this pedagogy is unsuccessful. As Mrs. Bloomfield explains to Agnes, "I thought when we got them a governess they'd improve, but instead of that they grew worse and worse. They got rougher and dirtier, more unseemly every day." It comes as no surprise when Agnes is dismissed from her job. One might be tempted to view the Bloomfield children's misbehavior and Agnes's misbegotten corrections as melodramatic excess. Until, that is, one reads some period memoirs. Master Tom's abuse of Agnes was not an anomaly. As Catherine Hughes explains, Victorian autobiographies are full of tales of governess baiting, a sport in which small boys, chafing under petticoat rule, were only too happy to lead. Nor was the Bloomfield children's gross misbehavior exceptional. Some of the favorite tricks of children recounted in one autobiography, Hughes notes, included placing a live crayfish in the governess's bed, putting mice into her tea caddy, or surreptitiously putting hedgehogs and squirrels in her bedroom. In fact, Agnes's extreme measures to counter her charge's misrule pale in comparison to some of the methods that are recalled in these memoirs. One man remembers that his governess spanked him with the sole of her slipper on the bare back, beat him with her brushes, tied him for long hours to chairs in uncomfortable positions with his hands holding a pole or blackboard behind his back, and shut him up in darkness. Agnes's experiences with the Bloomfield family mirror both other governesses' experiences and Anne's own. Like Agnes, Anne had to tutor poorly educated and unruly children, a young boy and his younger sister. We have no direct commentary from Anne about her experiences, but in a letter to her friend Ellen Nussey, Charlotte describes what her sister had to endure. Her pupils are desperate little dunces. Neither of them can read, or sometimes they even profess a profound ignorance of the alphabet. The worst of it is that the little monkeys are excessively indulged, and she is not empowered to inflict any punishment. Like Agnes, Anne had to resort to desperate means to maintain order. One Ingham family member recalling the children's mother saying she had gone into the schoolroom only to find two of the children tied to opposite table legs whilst Anne wrote. Ultimately, Anne, like Agnes, was dismissed by her employer and forced to return home in defeat. Agnes Grey, chapters 6 through 16. The second half of the novel details Agnes's experience as governess for the Murrays of Horton Lodge, which, like the family itself, is very respectable, superior to the Bloomfields both in age and magnificence. Agnes describes the class difference between the two families. Mr. Murray's residence was near a large town, and not in a manufacturing district where the people had nothing to do but make money. His rank appeared to be higher than that of Mr. Bloomfield, and doubtless he was one of those genuine thoroughbred gentry. Agnes is in charge of 4 children, 10-year-old Charles, 11-year-old John, 13-year-old Matilda, and 15-year-old Rosalie. Agnes will instruct the 2 girls for several years as they are preparing to enter society and to consider marriage. The 2 boys, however, one as rough as a young bear, boisterous, unruly, unprincipled, untaught, unteachable, the other pettish, cowardly, capricious, selfish, active in doing mischief, and only clever in inventing falsehoods, are quickly dispatched to boarding school, ostensibly because Agnes can't teach them, but in truth to allow Bronte to focus her intention on the education of girls. If the first half of Agnes Grey is a critique of the education of young children, particularly of boys, the second half is a critique of the education of adolescent upper-class girls, which Bronte achieves by contrasting Rosalie and Matilda and Agnes. Rosalie is an embodiment of this education, of what upper-class adolescent girls are taught to believe about themselves and their role in society. Rosalie's mother, whose chief enjoyments were in giving or frequenting parties and in dressing at the very top of the fashion, seeks the same life for her daughters. She was, Bronte writes, anxious only to render them as superficially attractive and showily accomplished as they could possibly be made. Agnes's job was to amuse and oblige, instruct, refine, and polish. Agnes generally gets along with the beautiful Rosalie, but she laments Rosalie's superficiality. Her mind, Agnes explains, had never been cultivated. Her intellect at best was somewhat shallow. She possessed a considerable vivacity, some quickness of perception, and some talent for music and the acquisition of languages, but at 15 she had troubled herself to acquire nothing. Rosalie applies herself only to those skills expected of a debutante, skills that will make her stand out in public, what Bronte labels showy accomplishments. French, German, music, singing, dancing, fancy work, and a little drawing. These are the skills middle and upper-class women are expected to possess as they, Agnes says of the 18-year-old Rosalie, emerge from their quiet obscurity into the full blaze of the fashionable world. Skills needed to attract and entertain a mate, to play the piano and sing, to dance gracefully, to converse in French, useful for a likely trip to Paris after the wedding. One of the novel's strengths is its demonstration of the destructive nature of this shallow exhibitionism, of becoming a coquette. Rosalie's only pleasure derives from being seen and admired. She attends church twice on Sundays because she so loved admiration that she could not bear to lose a single opportunity of obtaining it. And there was certain to be somebody present who would not be insensible to her charms. Living in the country, though, she has almost no opportunity to practice these charms, other than on the village's young, unmarried rector, Mr. Hatfield. Rosalie regularly meets him outdoors, causing her mother to fear that she might accept his hand in marriage. But Rosalie tells Agnes this notion is preposterous, that she would never consider marrying a man who has no fortune. And when he does propose, Rosalie not only turns him down, but relishes doing so. She gleefully recounts his suffering. "You should have seen how his countenance fell. He went perfectly white in the face. Oh, if you had seen how dreadfully mortified he was, how crushed to the earth by his disappointment. There was he, suffering so unspeakably, and there was I, the pitiless cause of it all, so utterly impenetrable to all the artillery of his looks and words, so calmly cold and proud." She even imagines Hatfield's despair as he shuts himself up in his study and cries, if he doesn't burst into tears before he gets there. Bronte condemns this callous indifference and cruelty. However, she is not merely pointing to the foibles of one foolish young girl, but is denouncing a system that entraps women in this narrow vision of themselves and their lives. This system is so destructive of genuine human impulses that Rosalie prides herself on being calmly cold, while denouncing the very concept of love. "It is quite beneath the dignity of a woman to do such a thing as falling in love," she explains. "Love, I detest the word, as applied to one of our sex. I think it is a perfect insult." Although she is a victim of this system, in Bronte's view, Rosalie is not a dupe. Her behavior is a rational response to an oppressive system. We learn the reasons for her cruelty in how she reacts to having tormented and rejected Hatfield. "I am delighted with myself," she claims, "for my prudence, my self-control, my heartlessness. He evidently idolized me, and yet I had the wisdom and the pride and the strength to refuse him, and scornfully and coolly as I did. I have good reason to be proud of that." What strange words to describe stringing a man along and then coldly turning him away. Delight, prudence, self-control, wisdom, pride, strength, and heartlessness. At 18, Rosalie is being pushed into marriage. She has disparaging things to say about all of her suitors. Sir Hugh Melvin is an old codger, Sir Thomas an ugly beast, Harry Meltham a younger son, hence not heir to his family's fortune, Mr. Green of no family and a great stupid fellow, and Mr. Hatfield of no money. About these men, she concludes, I really do detest them all. And yet Rosalie cherishes playing the role of coquette. She declares, If I could be always young, I would be always single. I should like to enjoy myself thoroughly and coquette with all the world, having made 10,000 conquests. That is, Rosalie dreams of lingering in this moment, being a perpetual object of desire, forever wanted and forever out of reach. But she knows she must marry, and marry well. Like most Victorian women of her class, she has no options, no education she can gain, nor career pursue. She is trapped. Although being a coquette is trivial and unrewarding, it's all she has. Denied love, education, and a profession. Denied the chance to find her own way in the world. Denied an independent identity. And forced at a young age to marry and bear the children of a man she is not attracted to, Rosalie relishes the role of coquette, because it's the only thing that gives her power. As she plainly admits about her flirtation with the curate Edward Weston, I intend him to feel my power. He shall acknowledge it, too. For Rosalie, love is a battlefield where she is impenetrable to all the artillery of a man's looks and words. It is a landscape she hopes will be strewn with her conquests. In this context, we can understand the words she used to describe her feelings about abusing Hatfield. She feels delight in overcoming men. She prides herself on having the self-control and strength and wisdom to rule her emotions. It is Hatfield, she imagines, who, like a woman, cries, while she, like a man, remains cool and emotionless. Ultimately, she prides herself on her heartlessness, because it is the key to dominating men, a domination that will disappear the instant she is married. Rosalie's sister Matilda is quite different. She is subject to the same limited education and confining gender rules, yet she does not embrace the role of coquette, is not interested in the acquisition of ornamental accomplishments, partly to create an identity separate from her sister, but more because she is interested in unwomanly things. Matilda almost completely violates the appearance and behavior expected of an upper-class teenaged girl. She is a strapping hoyden of about 14, with a short frock and trousers. A veritable hoyden, according to Agnes, she was far too big-boned and awkward ever to be called a pretty girl. Bronte's repetition within a few pages of the word hoyden may just reflect its more common usage in the 19th century, a hoyden being, according to the Oxford English Dictionary, a rude or ill-bred girl, a boisterous girl. It's worth noting, though, that one of the roots of hoyden is heathen. To be a mother, which should be Matilda's goal, is to be angel of the house, the moral force that binds a family with Christian love. To be a hoyden, then, is to violate expected female behavior, and thus be unchristian. And violate Matilda gleefully does. She had learnt to swear like a trooper. She is not interested in womanly things, but in horseback riding. When Agnes returns from a stay with her family, Rosalie and Matilda compete to tell her of their exploits. Rosalie about the ball she'd attended. Matilda about her new mare, asserting that she could clear a 5-barrel gate and that her father said she might hunt next time the hounds met. The essence of Matilda is seen in her reply to her sister's wishing she would be more ladylike and alleging that Matilda learned to swear from hanging around the stables. I learnt it from Papa, you ass, and his jolly friends, said the young lady, vigorously cracking a hunting whip which she habitually carried in her hand. I'm as good a judge of horse flesh as the best of them. Matilda's cracking whip should remind us of Agnes's former pupil Tom's saying how manfully he used his whip and spurs. And while Matilda doesn't seek to torture little birds, she does become tired of so helpless and troublesome a nursling as her dog Snap, and so lets Agnes take charge of it. When the dog shows Agnes more affection, it receives many a spiteful kick and pinch from Matilda, and is in danger of being put away. This cruelty toward animals, we have seen, is viewed as a masculine trait. Thus, Matilda's behavior is one more example of her violation of Victorian gender codes. To employ a phrase in common use in the 19th century, though not by Bronte, Matilda is a tomboy. As Mary Elliott asserts about their appearance in American post-Civil War fiction, tomboys challenged the limits of prevailing domestic conventions and principles. Their intrusions are always disruptive to rigid taxonomies of gender identity and to prevailing notions of appropriate private and public conduct for women. Whereas her sister gained power by playing the coquette, Matilda finds power in being a tomboy, in swearing and horse jumping and hunting and otherwise defying gender conventions. Bronte expresses some admiration for Matilda. As an animal, she writes, Matilda is full of life, vigor, and activity. But she laments Matilda's lack of intellect. As an intelligent being, she was barbarously ignorant, indocile, careless, and irrational. In later fiction, tomboys are sometimes depicted as compulsive readers, finding alternatives to their society's gender conventions and release from social pressures in the solitary act of reading, as memorably seen in the character Jo March in Little Women. Bronte, though, denies Matilda any such intellectual capacity. If she so greatly disrupts Victorian gender conventions, it seems, she cannot be smart. Bronte does not contemplate the possibility that Matilda aggressively dismisses her education because its goal is to transform her, to refashion her natural inclinations so that she will fit the model of a proper English gentlewoman. Or, as Agnes describes the goals of her instruction, cultivating her understanding, reforming her manners, and aiding her to acquire those ornamental attainments which, unlike her sister, she despised. Compared to the beautiful coquette Rosalie and the swearing tomboy Matilda, Agnes is an anemic figure. Agnes is gray. She describes herself as having a pale hollow cheek and ordinary dark brown hair. She acknowledges that there might be intellect in her forehead and expression in her dark eyes, but these can't compete with a low Grecian brow and large black eyes devoid of sentiment. Yet in her quiet manner, she is heroic. She values a real education. If Rosalie is too flightily consumed by coquetry, and Matilda too interested in an active physical life, if, in other words, Rosalie too wholly accepts Victorian gender beliefs, and Matilda too aggressively dismisses them, Agnes presents a model somewhere in between. A woman who prizes intellectual and moral education more than ornamental attainments, but who nonetheless behaves within the prescribed limits of Victorian womanhood. She criticizes the limited education planned for these girls, one meant not to challenge them or to cause them trouble and discomfort. Such instruction is consistent with how they have been raised, with constant indulgence and habitual scorn of reason. Of course, the Murray children do not need to be challenged intellectually or made to work hard because their wealth ensures them a life of comfort. Growing up in more straitened circumstances, Agnes has benefited from her mother and father's much broader and more challenging instruction. Thus, Agnes not only teaches the girls music, but the boys Latin. We can assume that her education was similar to what Anne and her siblings received from their father and aunt. Lessons in literacy, geography, history, maths, and a little French, as well as art, music, and sewing. That the wealthy children she teaches are not encouraged to learn deeply, in fact are barely to be challenged at all, is a continuing source of frustration for Agnes, and was for Anne as well. The Bronte sisters' exasperated reactions to the indolent offspring of the rich, writes literary critic Terry Eagleton, are clearly in part class responses. Much of the latter part of the novel, in fact, is a critique of the class system in Victorian England. As governess, Agnes has access to the ways of the upper class, She observes their attitudes toward and treatment of the lower classes. For instance, when Rosalie and Matilda visit the poor cottages on their father's estate, it is to receive their flattering homage and to enjoy the purer pleasure of making the poor people happy with their cheering presence and their occasional gifts. This paternalism and condescension and self-gratification, Agnes argues, stems from the girls' lack of empathy, their inability to imagine themselves in the position of the poor, and this imaginative failure, in turn, stems from a belief in their own superiority. They regard the poor as an order of beings entirely distinct from themselves, who, because they were poor and untaught, must be stupid and brutish, and who must adore them as angels of light. Nonetheless, Agnes is far from a class warrior. She does not tell us of the origins of the Bloomfields and the Murrays' wealth. Presumably, Mr. Bloomfield is connected to manufacturing, and all we know of Mr. Murray is that he is of the gentry. We do not know how these families accumulated the wealth that allows them to hire multiple domestic servants and stable hands and governesses like Agnes. Class in the novel, then, is not associated with capital accumulation or the exploitation of workers, but is a property that defines characters, mostly by appearance and behavior. Essentially middle class, Agnes strives to be accepted into the upper class while dissociating herself from the lower classes. She does not want to be perceived as just another domestic servant, who she sees as too easily corrupted by the carelessness and bad example of those above them. These servants' mistreatment of her, their adopting the views of their betters, Agnes argues, are due to their being ignorant and little accustomed to reason and reflection. Agnes and governesses generally straddle two worlds. By education, upbringing, and manner, they belong to the middle and upper classes. But by working for and earning money from wealthy families, they belong to the servant class. While they, like Anne, might at some level recognize their shared interests with house servants, their self-worth depends upon identifying with those they work for rather than those they work with. Agnes's attitude was shared by many women in her position. As M. Jean Peterson declares, there is no trace of militance in the ranks of mid-19th century governesses. Having lived with two wealthy families, and having had to interact with children, parents, and servants, Agnes has overcome her shyness and gained confidence. She acknowledges that she is as smart or smarter than these families and their wealthy acquaintances. I considered myself pretty nearly as good as the best of them, and wished them to know that I did so, and not to imagine that I looked upon myself as a mere domestic who knew her own place. But she is continually made aware of her inferior position. For example, even though Rosalie befriends her, she seldom lost sight for above half an hour at a time, Agnes explains, of the fact of my being a hireling and a poor curate's daughter. Constantly accompanying one or both of the Murray girls, Agnes is ignored and rendered almost invisible. The ladies and gentlemen talked over me or across, and if their eyes in speaking chanced to fall on me, it seemed as if they looked on vacancy. She does not catch the eye of an elder son or visiting member of the gentry. No prince will swoop in and remove her from her drudgery. In Bronte's governess tale, social class is an impassable boundary. Women like Agnes Grey, no matter how intelligent, cannot join the upper class, or even be made visible to them. In her 1865 guidebook, Principles of Education Drawn from Nature and Revelation and Applied to Female Education in the Upper Classes, Elizabeth Missing Sewell explains the cause of Agnes's and other governesses' frustration. The real discomfort of a governess's position in a private family arises from the fact that it is undefined. She is not a relation, not a guest, not a mistress, not a servant, but something made up of all. No one knows exactly how to treat her. Agnes experiences what sociologists call status incongruence. By habit and self-perception, she identifies with the Murrays. But by employment and others' perceptions, she is a servant. Fitting into neither category, she has no friends, other than the girls she tutors and the curate Weston, with whom she shares only brief conversations. Agnes bemoans her lonely state. The weary monotony, the lonely drudgery, never did I see one creature to whom I could open my heart or freely speak my thoughts or enjoy a single moment of real social intercourse. This lack of engagement with others, she fears, is destroying both her mind and her spirit. I seem to feel my intellect deteriorating, my heart petrifying, my soul contracting, and all my better faculties be sunk at last beneath the baleful influence of such a mode of life. Agnes's lament surely mirrors Anne's feelings, and those of many other governesses, and it explains Lady Elizabeth Eastlake's observation that the lunatic asylums of this country are supplied with a larger proportion of their inmates from the ranks of young governesses than from any other class of life. But a savior will appear to Agnes. Thus it was, she explains, that Mr. Weston rose at length upon me, appearing like the morning star in my horizon, to save me from the fear of utter darkness. Agnes Grey, chapters 17 through 25. Just as she contrasts the two sisters and Agnes, so Bronte contrasts two men of the cloth: the Reverend Hatfield, rector at the Horton Parish Church, and Edward Weston, his curate, in other words, his assistant, a man of false faith, Hatfield, and a man of true faith, Weston. We can see the differences between these two men and how they treat the poor. Hatfield rebukes an old ill woman for not attending services. Weston consoles her. Their differences are also seen in how they treat animals. Hatfield accidentally kicks this woman's cat across the floor, then goes off as gay as a lark. Weston allows the cat to jump on his knee, where he strokes her and gives a bit of a smile. Hatfield, this man of the cloth, even has a bit of Master Tom in him. When Matilda's dog Snap plays too aggressively, he, with his cane, administered a resounding thwack upon the animal's skull and sent it yelping back with a clamorous outcry that afforded the reverend gentleman great amusement. But the main contrast between the two men concerns the differences between two strains of Anglicanism: High Church, represented by Hatfield, and Low Church, or Evangelical, represented by Weston and practiced by Bronte's father Patrick. Bronte sees the High Church's emphasis on ritual as contrary to the true mission of Christianity. It's the difference between obeying church doctrine and conveying the wisdom of the Scriptures. This difference is seen in Hatfield's and Weston's sermonizing. Hatfield emphasizes church discipline, rites and ceremonies, apostolical succession, the duty of reverence and obedience to clergy, the atrocious criminality of dissent, and occasionally, to please his wealthy parishioners, the necessity of deferential obedience from the poor to the rich. Weston, on the other hand, preaches from the Scriptures, and does so passionately that the most careless person could not have helped attending, nor the most ignorant have failed to understand. Weston prays earnestly and sincerely from his heart, whereas Hatfield seems more acquainted with the church fathers than with the apostles and evangelists. The difference between the two men and their two faiths is reflected in the women they are attracted to. Hatfield, as discussed earlier, pursues the beautiful, wealthy, but shallow Rosalie, thereby demonstrating his own superficiality, his preoccupation with appearance and authority and wealth. Like Rosalie's upper-class acquaintances, Hatfield does not even see Agnes, once almost closing a carriage door on her. Eventually, he marries a wealthy spinster. Weston is briefly attracted to Rosalie, who flirts aggressively with him after she's ended things with Hatfield. But Weston is able to pierce her wiles, saying he saw she was giddy and vain, and so artful that she could assume an aspect of extreme simplicity and unguarded openness. The same insight that allows him to see through Rosalie's falsehoods allows him to render Agnes visible, to recognize her true nature. But their hesitant, unexpressed courtship is interrupted by the death of Agnes's father, which forces Agnes to return home. Her sister having married, Agnes and her mother begin a girls' school in a seaside village based on the town of Scarborough, where Anne had vacationed several times with the Robinson family. Agnes painfully waits for a letter from Weston that never comes. She does, however, receive a letter from the now-married Rosalie imploring her to visit. Hoping to meet Weston again, she agrees to return. But before we continue with Agnes's story, dear listener, we must first conclude the tales of the Murray sisters, Matilda and Rosalie. Matilda's fate is sealed by the dominant gender codes of the time. Unless she has the courage to deny her family and its wealth, she must swap trousers and frock coat for a floor-length skirt and whalebone corset. Her mother, truly alarmed at the roughness of her manners, prohibited entirely the yards, stables, kennels, and coach house. Matilda reacts, as one would expect, with many a scene of contention, many a violent outbreak. Her father, who Matilda had previously accompanied on his hunting adventures, likewise recognizes that she must now be re-educated. Even he could see that, though she would have made a fine lad, she was not quite what a lady ought to be. And so, reluctantly, Matilda gives in, finding her easiest plan was to keep clear of the forbidden regions, unless she could now and then steal a visit. When she last sees Matilda, Agnes observes that she was still wild and reckless, but she had got a fashionable governess, and was considerably improved in her manners, and soon to be introduced to the world. In other words, she will be surrendering the forbidden regions for the decorous social world, horseback riding for fine-dressed balls, the company of grooms and gamekeepers and horses, for the company of certain classes of gentlemen. Matilda's sister Rosalie becomes engaged, of course, to the wealthiest and most aristocratic of the suitors she detested, Sir Thomas Ashby. He is also, in Rosalie's words, the wickedest. Reluctant to marry, and wishing she could continue as coquette, she is unable to prolong her engagement or escape marriage due to her mother's heartlessness or want of thought for the real good of her child. That Mrs. Murray's lack of genuine concern for her daughter is attributed to her heartlessness should remind us of Rosalie's taking pride in her own heartlessness when rejecting Hatfield's proposal. We see here how the socializing process of upper-class women, which severs them from true feeling, distorts that most revered relationship in Victorian society, that between a mother and her child. Bronte shows us how this education in heartlessness is passed from one generation to another. When Agnes visits Rosalie after her marriage, the inevitable results of this pecuniary betrothal are apparent in Rosalie's greeting, "I'm Lady Ashby." "It's done. My fate is sealed. There's no drawing back now." This marriage has even degraded Rosalie's appearance. In 12 months, she has changed as much as one might expect in 12 years. The marriage has reduced the plumpness of her form, the freshness of complexion, the vivacity of her movements, and the exuberance of her spirits. She bewails these changes, telling Agnes, "It is bad to feel life, health, and beauty wasting away, unfelt and unenjoyed, for such a brute as her husband." Rosalie despises Sir Thomas and his wicked ways, his gambling, drinking, and spending time with his opera girls and his lady this and Mrs. that. In a culmination of the book's animal imagery, he is, Rosalie declares, a wild beast. Beginning with Master Tom and ending with Sir Thomas, Bronte shows the moral, intellectual, and physical damage generated from class privilege and male superiority. This insight is confirmed for Agnes when she encounters Sir Thomas while walking the Ashby estate. He was tall, thin, and wasted, somewhat blotchy, and disagreeably red about the eyelids. A general appearance of languor and flatness, relieved by a sinister expression about the mouth and the dull, soulless eyes. In many of these details, Bronte could be describing her brother Branwell, who more or less drank himself to death after the demise of his affair with his employer's wife. The dissolution Bronte briefly describes here is expanded in her portrayal of the drunken and debauched Arthur Huntington in her second and last novel, The Tenant of Wildfell Hall. Similarly, Rosalie anticipates the character Annabella Lowborough, who reluctantly marries to gain a title, and who has an adulterous affair with Huntington. Bronte hints that Rosalie, too, commits adultery. Her degraded appearance is blamed on the influence of fashionable dissipation, that is, an excessive indulgence of pleasure, often sexual pleasure, associated with the upper class. This perception is reinforced when Rosalie tells Agnes that her husband had accused her of coquetry and extravagance with Harry Meltham, the only suitor she seemed once to have been attracted to, and whom she had described as rather good-looking and a pleasant fellow to flirt with, but who had had the disadvantage of being a younger son. As punishment, Sir Thomas confines her to their estate, in Rosalie's words, like a prisoner and a slave, forced to lead the life of a nun so that she won't dishonor him or bring him to ruin. We see here the predictable double standard and male fear of female sexuality. Rosalie seems to admit having an affair with Meltham when she declares her husband's behavior was 10 times worse in every way, which would seem to grossly understate, only 10 times worse, the difference between merely flirting and his habitual adultery. In other words, she seems to be saying that her one affair can't compare with her husband's repeated flagrant adulteries. But this is only supposition, based on Sir Thomas's fear of being dishonored, on the convention of oblique sexual references in Victorian fiction, and on the more overt behavior of Lady Lowborough in The Tenant of Wildfell Hall. Like Lady Lowborough, who has 2 children she abandons to her husband, Rosalie has a daughter who she declares the most charming child in the world, seemingly because Rosalie does not have to nurse it. While such a cold expression would violate Victorian attitudes toward mothering, one might suspect that in practice, upper-class women like Rosalie surrendered this task to wet nurses. In reality, however, it had become increasingly common for middle and upper-class women to nurse their own children. As Catherine Hughes explains, The cholera outbreaks and political crises of the 1840s provided ample breeding ground for fears about all sorts of contamination which might seep from the working to the middle class via the tainted milk of the wet nurse. As a result, breastfeeding was redefined as a natural and healthy practice for the responsible middle-class mother, and childcare became a site for the separation and insulation of the middle class from corruption by the class below. Rosalie's refusal to nurse her children, then, violates both class practice and good mothering. Agnes remarks on Rosalie's utter lack of a mothering instinct. She seemed to regard her 7 or 8 weeks old child with no remarkable degree of interest or affection. When Agnes suggests that Rosalie might find consolation for the horrors of her marriage by solacing herself with the care and nurture of her little daughter, Rosalie declares she can't devote herself entirely to a child because it might die or grow to resemble her husband. Ultimately, her disregard for her daughter springs from what her daughter connotes. Rosalie is aging and losing that which gives her her only pleasure, her beauty and the rewards of being a flirt. "What pleasure can I have," Rosalie asks, "in seeing a girl grow up to eclipse me and enjoy those pleasures I am forever debarred from?" Thus, the coquetting skills Victorian culture promoted as necessary for marrying are what keep her from becoming what Victorian culture most desired for women, to be the loving mother of an angelic child. The narcissism of a coquette, in other words, keeps Rosalie from having any real connection to, never mind love for, her daughter. This disregard for her daughter is reminiscent of her own mother's absent feelings for her daughters. Rosalie's mother, like many other upper-class mothers in Victorian England, sees daughters as objects whose beauty and comportment are commodities that can, with a governess's aid, be traded for wealth and nobility. The last we see of Rosalie, she is imploring Agnes to stay a bit longer to distract from the prison of her marriage, from her deeply unhappy and lonely life. But Agnes, bidding adieu to poor Lady Ashby and her princely home, leaves to rejoin her mother. One day, as she strolls on the beach, Agnes encounters a familiar dog. It's Snap, Matilda's pet terrier. Before she knows it, she meets again the dog's new owner, Edward Weston, who has moved to a new parish because he had too much influence with the common people, and because he was not sufficiently tractable and submissive to Hatfield. Weston has been wandering the streets for months, hoping to bump into Agnes. And now, at last, Agnes writes, "He looked at me, and the flash of his dark eyes seemed to set my face on fire." When the man and dog depart, Agnes returns home full of gratitude to heaven for so much bliss and praying that her hopes might not again be crushed. And they won't be. From here, Bronte charts the stages of courtship and proposal, ending by revealing that at the time she is composing this narrative, Agnes is married to Weston and is the mother of 3 children. Agnes and Weston have only a modest income, unlike the wealthy Rosalie and Sir Thomas, but they married for love and therefore have a genuine connection. Bronte ends the novel where it began. Like Agnes's family before its financial disaster, the Westons live modestly and by economizing are able to save. "We manage not only to enjoy comfort and contentment ourselves," Agnes writes, "but to have every year something to lay by for our children and something to give those who need it." Unlike all of the upper-class women she met, Agnes loves her husband and children, seeks no great wealth or title, and gladly practices Christian charity. She has a happy ending. To anyone familiar with Anne Bronte's life, however, this ending is far more wistful than hopeful. Anne would have no children, and would not marry. The man Weston is based on, William Waitman, her father's curate, and the one man she seemed to have had a close relationship with, died from cholera 3 years before she began to write Agnes Grey. Her two eldest sisters died when Anne was only 5. Her mother died when Anne was just a newborn. Her brother Branwell died the year after her novel's publication. 3 months later, her sister Emily died. And 6 months after that, Anne herself, like Branwell and Emily, died from consumption. This knowledge darkens the romantic seaside reunion with Weston and his cheerful dog, and is made even darker with the knowledge that the terminally ill Anne was escorted by Charlotte to this very location, where, in a room overlooking the ocean, she died peacefully at age 29. Unlike the other Brontes, who are buried in Haworth, Anne is buried in the Anglican churchyard in Scarborough, not far from where she imagined Agnes on the beach with her husband-to-be. This final distancing from Emily and Charlotte mirrors Anne's literary reputation. They are the imaginative Brontes, she the moralizing realist. Despite attempts by literary critics to boost her reputation, Anne Bronte remains far less known and less read than her sisters. Like the character Agnes Grey, Anne Bronte is barely visible, a largely neglected author who nonetheless speaks urgently about the entrapping and destructive power of gender roles and class hierarchy.